The next item of business is topical questions, and at question number one I call Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Over the weekend, several news outlets reported that the Deputy First Minister had committed to a review of the new build heat standard, which bans direct emission heating in new build homes. Sorry? I'm sorry.
We have moved on to topical questions.
And yes.
If you just put your question, Ms Hamilton.
I haven't got it, actually. Have you got it? Have you got it then? Sorry. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on plans to review the new build heat standard.
Minister Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased that this has actually come up as a topical question, as I was due to be issuing a government-inspired question later today on this very topic. I've been listening to the concerns raised by communities and will be reviewing the regulations on wood-burning stoves and biomass boilers with an intention to adapt them to address the issues of inflexibility that they have raised. The outcome of this review will ensure resilience to interruptions of electricity and heating supply and respect for rural communities' culture and traditions and sustainable systems. I want to ensure climate-friendly alternatives to direct emissions are promoted in appropriate ways across Scotland, with no unintended consequences with regard to fuel poverty and sustainability, particularly in rural communities. And the review will be carried out in short order and be collaborative, including communities, businesses, local authorities, to ensure it reflects all views. And I'm just as keen to work collaboratively with colleagues in Parliament.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, surprise, surprise, the SNP have done another screeching U-turn. And over the weekend, we heard that the several news outlets had said that the Deputy First Minister had committed to a review of the new heat building standard, which bans emission heating in new build homes. But here we've heard it. We heard it on the weekend, but now we hear it here because the Minister was forced into this by answering this question. My party has long demanded these rules are changed. They are misguided, they are ill-formed, and they fail to understand the realities of rural life. So can the Minister give us a timetable for when she will undertake this review, now that she has finally given in to Scottish Conservative demands to review the ban on wood burners?
Minister.
Yeah, so first of all, I thank Rachel Hamilton for early sight for a supplementary question. But also, I can't work out whether or not she's happy that I'm reviewing the regulations or not. I can't quite make up my mind. All I can say to her is that when I got responsibility for this portfolio, it was obvious to me that there was issues being brought up, particularly by rural communities. Now, I'm a rural MSP. I will always listen to rural communities. The review is going to look at previous consultation responses and evidence, research, engagement notes, including the ones that were received after the introduction of the new standards. And I'm going to re-engage with the new build heat standard working group on this. Ms. Hamilton asks for an idea of when this will happen. The quickest possible, the earliest we can possibly get this back in front of Parliament will be post-recess. That is how long it's going to take in order to do that engagement, including with my parliamentary colleagues. And I'll be able to advise Parliament of the exact timing of that soon.
Rachel Hamilton.
Can I also thank Kate Forbes for early sight of the Minister's announcement? The Scottish stove industry is worth approximately £60 million annually and supports over 2,000 jobs across Scotland. Last week, the Scottish Conservatives met with 40 businesses and industry experts to hear about the impact of this ban. One company noted that since this ban, they have seen their first month with zero installations. Yeah. Another echoed this, stating that since 1st of April 2024, they have had 3 stove installation inquiries versus 20 in the same period in 2023. This equates to around £100,000 in lost revenue based on previous sales. As we saw with the HPMAs, with the DRS, the Greens and the SNP find it all too easy to ignore rural businesses and communities. Can the Minister confirm if compensation will be afforded to those businesses who have lost out because of the SNP's misguided approach?
Minister.
As I said before, I always take the impacts on rural communities very seriously. But I want to also address something that Rachel Hamilton and her colleagues have said in public on this. There is no blanket ban on wood-burning stoves. This is for new builds, and I am doing what I think a responsible minister and a responsible government would be doing and looking at potential unintended consequences of what's been put through. Now, I should point out to Ms Hamilton that regulations went through the committee, and every member of that committee voted in favour of them, including two Conservative members. So no one raised any of these points. However, I have been hearing from the people in rural Scotland on this specifically, including the organisations that we mentioned, and I am committed to reviewing these regulations.
Thank you. Emma Roddick.
Thank you. Can I ask the Minister what consideration the Scottish Government is currently giving to the necessity in many communities of using solid fuel owing to the energy crisis and associated cost of living impacts which the deliberate policies of the Conservative Party have inflicted on our rural areas?
Minister.
Now, I am glad that Emma Roddick has raised the issue of rural fuel poverty. Scotland suffers the highest level of fuel poverty anyway, even before the fuel crisis. So this is a very important point. And we recognise that homes in rural communities can face additional challenges in decarbonising their properties, including the higher costs associated with that. So that's why we provide a rural uplift for both energy efficiency measures and clean heating systems as part of our generous funding offer. It's also why in our recent consultation proposals for a heat and buildings bill, we acknowledge the value of secondary and backup heating systems to many existing rural homes, and we did not propose that any future regulations prohibiting the use of polluting heat should apply to these secondary and backup systems. We'll continue to support owners in rural areas to make the transition by ensuring our approach to decarbonising buildings promotes fairness, feasibility and affordability and is rural and island proof. But it is true, many people were using gathered wood to boost the heat in their homes, particularly during the fuel crisis. Emergency situations aren't just power cuts for people in those situations.
Jamie Harker-Johnston.
Thank you. Coming after the campaign led from these benches with the industry and ahead of my debate tomorrow, I am actually pleased to see this review undertaken, but it is only a review and not a full reversal of the ban, which is what we want to see. So when the Scottish Government finally recognises their mistakes and listens to the communities right across the area I represent and across rural Scotland and are forced to drop these proposals, will they commit to undertaking economic analysis of the financial impact of the disastrous wood-burning stoves ban?
Minister.
No one is forcing me to do anything. I came into this post with this responsibility, concerned about the inflexibility that these regulations put forward. So I am doing exactly what Jamie Harcourt accuses me of not doing. I am listening to the views of rural Scotland. I am reacting to those views that have been in my inbox since I took responsibility for this area. And I am reviewing the regulations.
Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask if the Minister will ensure that she looks at emergency fuel sources? In the previous legislation, they were to be temporary and portable. I'm sure she knows that a wood-burning stove cannot be portable. It needs a chimney. And will she also take consideration of woodland crofts, which were created especially to ensure a sustainable fuel source for those homes?
Minister.
The thing that Rhoda Grant has just said there has been in my mind as well, particularly householders who are building new builds where they want to put in a biomass boiler because they've got a sustainable supply of wood for it. This is something that has been brought to my attention, not least from Rhoda Grant herself and the communication that we've had. I'm happy to work with the member to actually hit on some of the reasons why there has been such a backlash, I suppose, from rural communities to this. There's not actually that many people putting wood-burning stoves or biomass into new builds. That's about 4% over the past 10 years. But for those that are doing it, they are doing it not thinking that they're going to be polluting. They're doing it because they want to have a sustainable fuel and mitigating some of the impacts of the lack of choice they've got in heating their homes.
Patrick Harvey.
The Minister is well aware that the new build heat standard didn't cover emergency and backup systems, and also that the building standards regime itself already includes flexibility like derogations if new housing developments have to be put in an area where they can't be connected to the electricity grid and therefore can't use clean heating systems. So isn't it clear that the situation we have now is that all we need is a little bit of lobbying from vested interests and a little bit of misinformation, and the SNP will now start unravelling modest measures
Members
will now start unravelling even modest measures that have been put in place for good reasons. Given that the Cabinet Secretary, who previously signed off this measure today, was unwilling to commit to the NZEC committee for a timetable for introducing the Heat in Buildings Bill, how much confidence can anyone have that the Scottish Government remains committed to this challenging agenda?
Minister.
So I'm going to agree with one part of what Mr Harvey said, in that there's been a lot of misinformation around this. And it gives me the opportunity to state again that these regulations were never a ban on wood-burning stoves. And that misinformation has been perpetrated by people, particularly on that side of the chamber. But what is also true is that people in rural and island communities have brought to my attention areas in which they do not want to pollute. They want to live sustainably. And part of that might be choosing a wood-burning stove or a biomass boiler for their new build because they might have a sustainable supply. I want to listen to those rural communities. I want to listen to those voices. I think it's what a responsible government should do. And I'll be happy to take Mr Harvey's views on this as well.
We must move on to question number two, and I call Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it is working to build resilience to flooding, following reports to heavy rain and flooding causing drivers to be stranded on the Edinburgh City bypass for hours.
Cabinet Secretary Mary McCallum.
Presiding Officer, I should like to begin by expressing my sympathy for those impacted by heavy rain of last week, and also my thanks to those who responded to the events. These extreme weather events are increasing as a result of climate change, which is why improving flood resilience is a priority for the Government. In response to the severe weather on Thursday, and in particular that flooding on sections of the Edinburgh bypass, Transport Scotland worked with Bear Scotland to deploy pumps to clear the carriageway, whilst Police Scotland carried out welfare checks of those stuck in flooding, as well as ensuring that diversions were in place. Now, in the face of increasing challenges as a result of climate change, the Government is taking a suite of actions to build resilience. These include increased investment in flood risk management, as well as funding the Scottish Flood Forum and supporting SEPA with their flood forecasting service. Transport Scotland are also planning for and investing in adaptation, including in schemes to improve drainage and realign water courses. And on strategic planning, the Scottish Government is also taking forward actions, including the consultation I opened last week on our flood resilience strategy and our adaptation strategy, which we'll publish this year.
Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer. This is not the first time that Edinburgh City Bypass has seen flooding. It should be a high priority for flood protections. Yet the Flood Resilience Strategy consultation neglects our transport network in building new resilience to flooding. What risk assessment has the Scottish Government carried out, and what investment will it make to ensure our roads and railway are not closed and people's live disrupted, as we will increasingly see disruptive and damaging extreme weather?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I would just open my response by pointing out that I think more than a month's rain fell in a 36-hour period on Thursday and Friday of last week. The Esk at Musselburgh rose to its second highest level on record, and the Eddleston Water at Peebles reached its highest level on record. So these are unusual events exacerbated by climate impacts. Mr Chowdhury raised the issue of transport planning and actions that Transport Scotland are taking. Well, in terms of that strategic approach in 2023, their strategic framework was published, which looked explicitly at adaptation on Scotland's transport network. And I also mentioned in my opening response some of the practical investments that are being made to build resilience on our transport network to climate change, including in the last financial year, where £2.5 million were spent on 17 drainage improvement schemes and on one watercourse realignment. That is just one example of how Transport Scotland are investing to adapt our system.
Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. During the heavy rainfall this week, constituents raised concern with me once again that sewage could be discharged into the water of Leith. When the Scottish Government ditched its 2030 climate target, I warned that inaction on the climate would result in more heavy rainfall, flooding, and potentially more sewage in our waterways. I requested a meeting to discuss this combined sewage overflows with the Cabinet Secretary, but I was told it would not be useful. So will the Cabinet Secretary show the Scottish Government is taking this seriously and restore the public's confidence by meeting with me and the campaigners on this issue?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the tenor of this question it pertains to water quality as opposed to flooding, but I'm happy to answer it and to give an update to Parliament, which is, on the one hand, that 87% of Scotland's entire water environment is assessed by SEPA as having good or high classification. That's up from 82% 6 years ago. But we aren't complacent. Scottish Water is committed to installing, for example, 1,000 new spill monitors by the end of this year, and their Improving Urban Waters route map demonstrates work underway. And just to give some figures around that, 230 new spill monitors have been installed at priority locations. This was done by the end of 2023. By the end of March 24, over 800 of the promised 1,000 spill monitors had been installed, so Scottish Water is well on track to deliver that commitment, and detailed solutions are currently being developed to address 104 high-priority, unsatisfactory combined sewer overflows. And I hope that that information and more that I'm happy to provide to the member can give him some reassurance.
Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I think it is important that the Cabinet Secretary did acknowledge how distressing this was for families. I spoke to constituents who had young children and for hours were stuck on the bypass. So do also want to pay tribute to our emergency services for the work that they did. But can I ask specifically, Edinburgh City Bypass has been desperate for investment for many years. I have raised this in all the time I have been a Member of Parliament. Sadly, we are seeing delay after delay to investment, for example, the delivery of the new Sheriff Hall Junction. So can I ask whether or not the Scottish Government will now undertake a full review of the bypass to look towards the impact incidents like this are having and make sure we get on and deliver investment Edinburgh needs?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I would just echo Miles Briggs' comments in respect to the hard work that our emergency services do and did last week, and also the impact that being stuck in traffic and in flooding can have on people and families. On the question of infrastructure and transport infrastructure and the bypass transport infrastructure particularly, I shall have to defer to my colleague, the Cabinet Secretary for Transport, who I'm sure will be happy to update Miles Briggs on that issue.
Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I declare an interest as a regular user of the bypass to get to my constituency, which I was doing on Thursday night, got stuck on the bypass. Sheriff Hall to the first slip road off east to west is to Pennycook. Took me over an hour to get there. Can I ask if any consideration has been given to opening up the central crash barrier temporarily, stopping the west to east traffic and allowing those stuck going in the opposite direction to turn around and get off the bypass? And I certainly didn't see any police during my time on that road.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'm very sorry to hear that Christine Graham was caught up in the events of last week. I think the question that she poses is one not only that isn't my portfolio responsibility and is largely transport, but also it's an operational question about what's best in the circumstances, one that I think is probably for experts in Transport Scotland, in Bear Scotland and indeed in Police Scotland. But I'm sure that Fiona Hislop, who's sitting to my left, has heard Christine Graham's question and will be glad to look into the matters for her.
Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The now frequent occurrences of extreme weather events demonstrates the changing climate in Scotland and the difficulties that our communities face in adapting to it. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that opposition parties must work with the SNP as the Flood Resilience Strategy for Scotland develops to ensure parliamentary consensus on this issue in order to confront our climate challenges?
Cabinet Secretary.
I do, Presiding Officer. I mentioned previously that improving flood resilience is Scotland's largest climate adaptation challenge. Our communities who are facing increasing threats of climate change, they want to see their parliamentarians working together, and I would ask that all those across the chamber not only engage with the consultation on the resilience strategy, but encourage their constituents to do likewise, and I look forward to working with members across the chamber on this.
A brief supplementary, Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary, can I also add my thanks to the police and other emergency services who reacted so quickly last week? Would you agree with me that one of the issues of Eimish is that drains are no longer being cleared and thus there is a blockage in regard to that. And would she encourage Edinburgh City Councils and other local authorities to take a more regular approach to clearing drains so they're not blocked when we have this flooding?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, again, these are operational matters and I wouldn't propose to circumvent the responsibility not just of Edinburgh City Council but also of BEAR and of Transport Scotland, who I know from my own constituency experience, BEAR Scotland have been excellent in responding to drains that have required clearing in my area when flooding has been either threatened or has happened. So I'm sure they've heard Mr Balfour's comments today and will be considering all of this in light of recent events.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions.